Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to our service of Holy Eucharist for Christ the King. We've got me for the first half of the service, and then there'll be a seamless change of seats between Melanie and I halfway through. You won't even notice.
Oh, yes.
Should we stand and sing our first hymn? Jesus is King, and I will extol him. And we worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace and peace be with you.
And keep you in the love of Christ.
Father of glory, holy and eternal, look upon us now in power and mercy. May your strength overcome our weakness, your radiance transform our blindness, and your Spirit draw us to that love, shown and offered to us by your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Do be seated. As we prepare to confess our sins on this Feast of Christ the King, we call to mind and reflect on some of the truths of Jesus as our King. Lord Jesus, you came to gather the nations into your kingdom of peace. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you come in word and sacrament to strengthen us in holiness. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you will come in glory to judge the living and the dead. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
So in a few moments silence, we reflect on our lives. We reflect on the thoughts, words and actions that have displeased our Lord and King. Let us confess our sins together. Heavenly Father, we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and have failed to do what we ought to have done. We are sorry and truly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and lead us in his way to walk as children of light. Amen. Bydd ydy'r holl alluog Dduw sy'n maddau i bawb sy'n wired i ffeiriol, drygarhau wrthyn, a'n ryddhau o bechod, yn cadarnhau mewn daioni, a'n cadw yn y bywyd trygweddol, trwy Iesu Grist ein harbwydd. Amen. With the reassurance that our sins have been forgiven, because Jesus died and rose again for us and is now seated on his throne at God's right hand, let's praise him with the words of the Gloria. Eternal Father, whose Son Jesus Christ ascended to the throne of heaven, that he might rule over all things as Lord and King. Keep the Church in the unity of the Spirit and in the bond of peace, and bring the whole created order to worship at his feet. Grant this for the sake of your Son Jesus Christ, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for our reading from Paul's letter to the Colossians.
The reading this morning is taken from Colossians 1, verses 9 to 20. So you can find this on page 1182. Colossians 1, 9 to 20, on page 1182. For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of his will through all the wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives, so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, and being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father, who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of his holy people and the kingdom of light. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Supremacy of the Son of God. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. This is the word of God.
We remain seated as we sing our next hymn.
Thank you.
Gospel reading is from Luke's Gospel, chapter 23, beginning at verse 33, on page 1060. Would you please stand? Listen to the Gospel of Christ according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was a written notice above him which read, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that your word is recorded for us in Scripture. We thank you that Jesus died and rose again for us. And so as we come to study the narrative of his crucifixion this morning, we pray that our hearts and minds may be open to your teaching. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Do be seated. The history of the English and later British monarchy is full of interesting characters. We've had kings who've become almost legendary. Alfred burning the cakes, and Canute trying to stop the incoming tide. We've had kings who died on the battlefield in their attempts to keep the throne. Then there's Henry VIII, who stopped at nothing, including removing the Pope's authority over the church in England, then divorcing and beheading several of his wives to get what he wanted. And what about the kings whose deaths were sought by others? Not on the battlefield, but by plotters who failed, in the case of James I, and Parliament who succeeded, in the case of Charles I. Kings are not always popular. They often have enemies, as we've seen in some of the examples I spoke of. Sometimes their right to rule has been disputed too, causing war or rebellion. But what about a king who nobody recognised as a king? It seems unlikely, doesn't it? Surely kings have coronations, they live in palaces, they wear expensive clothing, occasionally wear a crown. Yet this is how Jesus came to be in the situation we read of in our Gospel this morning. His teachings about himself led ultimately to his arrest and trial, and now to the cross, precisely because those in authority did not recognize him as king. The crucifixion narrative is a familiar one, and we won't be looking at it itself. Instead, on this festival day of Christ the King, we'll see Jesus' kingship denied as he was crucified. We'll see the truth of his kingship revealed ironically in mocking, and we'll see his kingship acknowledged by an unlikely party. Well, first let's consider how Jesus' kingship was denied as he was crucified. If we turn back to the beginning of chapter 23, we see when the religious leaders first denied Jesus' kingship in this series of events, as they brought Jesus before Pilate in verse 2, saying, "We have found this man subverting our nation. He opposes payment of taxes to Caesar and claims to be Messiah, a king." Their words and actions demonstrate that they refute Jesus' claim. Some of the other Gospels in this same narrative record an outright denial to Pilate: "We have no king but Caesar." In the opening verses of our Gospel passage, we see the outcome of that denial and denial in action, as Luke records the crucifixion in verses 33 and 34. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The King of Kings, the Messiah, led out to die among criminals, as a criminal, because crucifixion was the method of execution for the very worst criminals, bandits and revolutionaries. He was stripped of his clothes. Later, they were shared among the soldiers. And then he was nailed to the cross. No one witnessing those things would have thought they were in the presence of a king. There are still many who deny Jesus' kingship, those who fail to recognize him as king, or those who refuse to accept him as king. And we often pray for their eyes to be opened and their hearts to be softened. Yet, as we've considered in our recent studies of James's letter and Paul's letter to the Philippians, there are times when we too ignore Jesus as king. When we place our own desires and priorities above his, or when we give more sway in our lives to anything other than Jesus, be that money, relationships, or our leisure time, we too, however temporarily, are placing those things on Jesus' throne. We're making self-centered instead of God-centered decisions. Fortunately for us, as he did to those who crucified him, Jesus reaches out with forgiveness. Let's look now at how Jesus' kingship was revealed, ironically, in mocking. From the spite of their words, it's apparent that those who were watching the crucifixion, the religious leaders and the soldiers, did not believe that Jesus was king. In fact, they were so certain that he was not a king that they mocked him and taunted him as he hung on the cross. The first accusation occurs in verse 35. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." They made the issue the person of Jesus, if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one. Because to them, the Messiah was a warrior, a deliverer. What the onlookers and religious leaders hadn't seen is that in accepting the way of the cross, which was failure in their eyes, Jesus was doing exactly that. He was delivering them, not from the Romans as they hoped, but from their sins, taking the punishment for sin upon himself. Well, then the soldiers join in the mocking. In verses 37 and 38 we read, they said, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." And there was a written notice above him which read, "This is the king of the Jews." Though they mock Jesus, they inadvertently speak the truth about who he is. And the inscription nailed to Jesus' cross too, though placed in irony, is testimony to Jesus. The final mockery comes in verse 39. one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. His motivation for mocking Jesus isn't made clear. But maybe there's something self-serving in his words, telling Jesus he should save them as well as himself. Jesus doesn't respond to any of his mockers, not the religious leaders or the soldiers or the criminal beside him. He doesn't need to. There's not only the irony of their mocking and taunts inadvertently testifying to Jesus' kingship, but also Jesus' knowledge that his death was not the end, that his resurrection would be its own testimony to who he is. Messiah, chosen one, and king. Well, it isn't the mocking criminal who has the final word in our passage. For in the final verses, we see Jesus' kingship acknowledged by an unlikely party. The criminal crucified on the other side of Jesus rebuked the first, pointing out that while they both deserved their punishment, Jesus did not, because he had done nothing wrong. Then in verse 42, he made the most astonishing request. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. To the human mind, for these words to come from a convicted criminal near death is unlikely. We should always remember, though, that all things are possible with God. The criminal's heart had been opened to who Jesus is, and he had understood the impact that Jesus' death would have, restoring humans' relationship with God and the possibility of life beyond death. So he reached out to Jesus, seeking forgiveness in his final moments and pleading with Jesus to have mercy on him and save him. This statement of faith and acknowledgement stands in stark contrast to the denial and mocking that has gone before. And Jesus accepted his faith and his plea, offering a generous and grace-filled reward. As he had done so often in the past, Jesus gave more than was expected, requested. The criminal asked to be included in the resurrection when creation is restored. Jesus offered something more wonderful. Truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. It's a most solemn promise. Jesus' phrase, truly I tell you, is the one he often used to reassure his listeners of the truth of his words. Additionally, though those who mocked him would not see it, Jesus did for the criminal who believed what they believed he could not do. He saved him while on the cross. That same reward is available to all who believe in Jesus, who recognize him as Messiah, the chosen one. Jesus' death on the cross was sufficient to save the whole of humanity, past, present, and future. All that's required of us in return is that we acknowledge Jesus as Lord and King. We should also recognize our sins before God, as the believing criminal did, believing as he did that all will be forgiven and will be made worthy through Jesus of a place in the resurrection. The question that arises is, what happens next? What do we do after we've received that assurance of forgiveness? We find the answer in the stories of others who encountered Jesus. Their lives were changed by those encounters. Matthew, a tax collector for the Romans, who gave up his lucrative career to become a disciple of Jesus. Zacchaeus, who was so altered by meeting Jesus that he immediately pledged to repay, and more than repay, those he had cheated. Mary Magdalene, who funded Jesus' ministry after he released her from her spiritual possession. We too can allow our lives to be changed by our encounter with Jesus. The changes may not need to be as dramatic as those we've mentioned, but for some people they may well be. But one of the most effective ways we can witness to Jesus as Lord and King is by demonstrating the difference he makes in our lives. If the thought of that is daunting, then we can be reassured too that Jesus is not a remote, unapproachable king on his throne. He's promised to be with us forever, and we can ask for his guidance. So let's approach him in prayer together now. Lord Jesus, you are King of Kings, God's chosen one, and our Saviour. We thank you for showing your power to save in the most unlikely way, in your death on the cross. Thank you that by your Spirit you're always with us. We pray that you'll guide us through your Spirit in our decisions to keep you at the centre of our lives, that we may not place anything else in your rightful place on the throne. May we always acknowledge your kingship with sincerity. Help us too to live lives changed for you and by you, because you have made us worthy of forgiveness. We ask this for your glory. Amen. We believe that we have a king who died and rose again and is seated at God's right hand. And so let's stand and declare our faith together.
I believe and trust in God the Father, who created all that is. I believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ, who redeemed humankind. I believe and trust in his Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God. I believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please be seated as we come before God in prayer.
O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. We praise you for giving us the privilege of prayer. Thank you that Christians in every corner of the world can join in worshipping you. We know that for many, faith expressed in you can lead to difficulties and often persecution. We ask that to those who suffer, you bring comfort. To those who are discouraged, you bring hope. To those who are weak, you bring strength. To those whom you call to support the persecuted, you bring resolve and encouragement. May your presence guide and protect your people wherever they are. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we bring your church here in the UK before you now. Thank you for all who faithfully follow your teaching and seek to deepen their relationship with you. We pray for all who have chosen to serve you in ministry and leadership. Grant them the stamina to carry out their myriad duties within the church, and inspire them by your Holy Spirit as they teach and guide their congregations. We ask that you protect and encourage all priests and ministry teams as they care for their churches. Thank you for Melanie, Rhiannon, Gavin and Darren. Bless their work in this place, O Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we continue to ask for your peace to be evident in conflict zones throughout the world. We know that you alone are sovereign, Lord, and that the earth is your creation. We pray especially for Ukraine and its people, and thank you for the resilience shown in the face of oppression. We pray for a lasting peace and for your Holy Spirit to guide those with the power to bring it about. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Within our own community, Lord, we bring before you those who are finding life challenging. Many may be wondering how to manage financially. We think especially of those with family responsibilities, whether young children, teenagers, or older relatives. We pray that your Spirit will will whisper reassurance that you care for them in every aspect of life. We pray that as Christmas approaches, people may be drawn to the church and that we may be ambassadors for Christ as we welcome them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we ask you to be with those who are experiencing ill health or anxiously awaiting test results. Grant them your peace and an awareness of your presence. Comfort those who are mourning the loss of a loved one, and be with those who are lonely. We name all those known to us before you now, in the silence of our hearts. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers
for the sake of your Son, our
Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Sue. Would you stand for a peace? The kingdom of God is righteousness, peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share with one another a sign of peace. Peace be with you. Weakness and majesty.
Thank you. celebrate together the gifts and grace of God.
We take this bread, we take this wine, to follow Christ's example and obey his commands.
The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
True and living God, the source of life for all creation, you have made us in your own image. Always and everywhere we give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord, whose dominion is over all creation, that he may present to you an eternal and universal kingdom, a kingdom of life and truth, of grace and holiness, a kingdom of righteousness and justice, of love and peace. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we praise your glorious name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
And digedi goiti ddiw hollachliog. Amiraglwydd Iesu, yn os abadwchwyd ef gymryd bara, ac wedi rhwy diolch i ti, fe torodd, a'i rhwy i ddisgyblu yn y dweud, cymerwch bwytawch, hwn i fy hoff a roddi drosodd, rhaid hyn e'r cof amdana. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given you thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come in glory.
Therefore, loving God, recalling now the sacrifice of Christ your Son, once for all upon the cross, and the triumph of his resurrection, we ask you to accept our sacrifice of praise. Send your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts, that we may be fed with the body and blood of your Son, and be filled with your life and goodness. Unite us in Christ, and give us your peace, that we may do your work and be his body in the world. Through him, with him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
So as our Saviour taught us, we boldly pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever.
Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body.
For we all share in one
breath. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. So come. Let us receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for us, and feed on him in our hearts by faith, with thanksgiving.
the Lord, for he is gracious.
His love is everlasting.
Generous God,
you have fed us at your heavenly table. Kindle us with the fire of your Spirit, that when the Lord comes again, we may shine as lights before him, who is alive and reigns in glory forever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
So our notices for today. Well, first of all, a really, really big thank you to everybody who was involved yesterday in our Christmas fair, in particular Heather and Lynette, who organised it, but everybody who was here and worked so hard, and Anne and Francis in the kitchen all day, and others who helped, and those who were on stalls, those who are here to do all the troubleshooting like Joe and clearing up and all of that. It was such a big team effort, so thank you so much to everybody who took the time and the effort yesterday, and to those who came and spent money as well, because it would be pointless without it. We raised £1,368.50. So that was a really, really good effort.
And can I just say that lots of people I had the opportunity of talking to, particularly the people that had rented tables off us, they all want to come back again. They've had the most wonderful time. They thought the friendship and welcome that they were shown here, they've never received it anywhere else.
Oh, that's brilliant. That's a wonderful testimony.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah, fantastic. Great. Sue? Darren, come and say something about the advent calendars.
Oh, it's okay. Yeah.
Yes, there. Because otherwise the people at home can't hear.
Hello, people at home. I got some advent calendars which I ordered a box of 18, but I had 12 we bought, but it's actually 13. So basically I've got about 5 left. So if anyone wants an advent calendar, I know you're one of the ones who already banked one. So if anyone wants, I've got 5 spares, £4.50 each. They're the real fair trade chocolate ones with little booklets telling the story of Christmas. So anyone wants one, come and see me. Thank you.
Do you have something to add, Samuel?
Nice chocolate.
Yes. Yeah, so they're at the back as well. I'll see Darren about those. A word about communion. We've now been given a pathway to get people licensed to do the chalice again. So once we've got people licensed, we will return to the way we used to do communion. If you'd like to be licensed to administer the chalice, then have a word with me or Liz or Rhiannon after the service. We can give you training and we'll put your name forward at the next MAC meeting, because the Ministry Area Council needs to approve the names. It will be on the nod. They're not going to ask for your profile or anything, I don't think so anyway. But that's the process, and then we can get you licensed, and then we will return to the way we used to do it. So if you think that's something you'd like to do, name to me Liz or Rhiannon. Any other notice? Everything is back to normal this week. I'm not going to be doing now the admission to communion class due to people not being available after all, so we'll think again about that maybe in the new year. But everything else is going on as planned. Reshma is doing another money course starting on the 28th of November. Reshma's here today. Give a wave, Reshma, in case somebody doesn't know you. I think most people know Reshma. Have a chat with Reshma about the course, which has been, people have found really helpful. Anything else I need to be announcing?
Christmas services on
the back. Oh yeah, Christmas services are on the back. The Christmas cards will be coming soon, so we will need help in distributing those around the village, so watch out for that. But do make a note of when the Christmas services are and at which church they're at. Don't forget, we've got three churches, so don't forget to check where they are. Ah, yes, of course, yeah. It's Hayley's mum's funeral tomorrow at 2 o'clock here in church. I know that Hayley would love to have church family around her to support her and Evie. So, and she's doing food afterwards as well in the cafe. So do please come if you can and support Hayley and Evie and the family tomorrow, 2 o'clock.
Somebody had a big birthday this week.
Naomi did turn 18, it was last Monday. So should we sing happy birthday to
Naomi? Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday dear Naomi, happy birthday to you.
Hip hip.
Hooray!
Hip hooray!
Hip hooray!
No, I've got no children anymore, they're both grown-ups.
But you've got a grandchild.
But we've got Sammy. Christ the King make you faithful and strong to do his will, and bring you to reign with him in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each one of you, now and always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
You can sit down when they report back. Want us to pretend we're good. He wants us to recognise where we've been wrong so that we can be forgiven and made right with him. That's a really important message for all of us to hear. So thank you. And sorry I forgot. I knew there was something I was not remembering here. So always remind us, Scatterbrained Vicar.